First on BBC One, Michael Burke with 999.
All of tonight's rescues are true stories. We've sometimes used actors and stuntmen, but everything you see is based on the accounts of the people involved. They've helped us to reconstruct the events as they happened. On 999, seconds to spare. Would you dare to put your life on the line for a stranger? Plus Moggy, the much-loved Morris Minor, whose old-fashioned strength repaid its owner's love and affection. This is the Scorpion House at London Zoo, where some of the deadliest small creatures in the world are kept safely behind glass. But on your holidays, you may find yourself getting too close for comfort to the likes of these and other venomous animals like snakes and spiders. And if you do get bitten, you may have only hours to live unless you can get to hospital for an anti-venom injection. Even then, as a party of British tourists found in Jordan, there's no guarantee of survival.
Myself and my friend Ian Gray went out on a holiday initially to learn to dive.
Right, all together. And cheese! Gotcha.
We met up with some people, Elspeth, Jerry and Caroline, when we were diving. Jordan's quite a famous place for Wadi Rum, the place where Lawrence of Arabia was filmed. So we hired a four-wheel drive and headed off, really, to have a bit of a desert adventure. Wadi Rum is this amazing place. It's one of the most incredible moonscape-like landscapes I think I've ever seen. And we were a bit irresponsible, I suppose, in hindsight, but we just went off and lost ourselves in the desert.
I'm sorry.
The group of five included Mark, his work colleague Ian, their new travelling companions Caroline Hopkins and Jerry and Elspeth Dugdale. They'd all decided to sleep under the stars.
Elspeth, you're not still worried about being attacked, are you?
Well, I was just bothered.
It seemed like a great adventure, but I was a little bit apprehensive. Perhaps at the back of my mind was, experiences walking around in the dark in India, where you have to be very careful, you know, that you do have sandals on or shoes on, that you what you put your feet on.
I was brought up in Zambia, so I lived there for 7 years. And during a part of that time, I kept black scorpions, much to my mother's horror. So we were slightly aware of the risks, but we're desperate to camp out under the stars.
OK, guys, you ready for a photo?
Tourists should take care about scorpions because they are active during the night and they are very, very dangerous. We should search our clothes or blankets or the sleeping bags. Any mistake can cause his death.
In the morning when we woke up, there was all these strange tracks in the sand around us. And of course, they all turned out to be scorpion tracks. And then we went off to the ancient city of Petra. That part of Jordan is a spectacular drive as you go higher and higher into the mountains and you're looking down over the great desert plains and salt flats. The thing I didn't realise about Petra is it's so big. It's basically a vast valley complex of temples, tombs, houses. There's at least a couple of miles of the valley floor to walk through.
You walk through the Sikh, it's quite a long walk, and we didn't want to take donkeys, we wanted to walk it together. And you step out from the Sikh and you see the treasury. And it is literally jaw-dropping. I've never seen anything like it.
And then, if you want to see the really beautiful buildings, you have to climb up one of the mountains.
When we started the ascent up the mountain, I did notice the first aid post at the bottom. I don't know why. I wasn't looking for one.
It was late afternoon as the group set off, but the temperature was still in the 90s.
So I keep turning around and looking back.
I think it's at least 45 minutes. Quite a hard climb to get to the top.
Oh, that is beautiful.
Oh,
it's so tired.
Brilliant.
You like some tea?
Some tea? A bit later?
Yeah.
Yeah, right, when we come
5 minutes. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
We'd walked up to the edge of the mountain, had a look around there, and the scenery again is fantastic.
That's fantastic in the sunset, isn't it?
Right behind us was this amazing palace building, which is just huge. And I think I said something which I think is pretty immortal now, considering what happened next. I think I said something like, this is just too perfect, isn't it?
How about a group photo?
Good idea.
Self-timer. Self-timer.
Yeah, if you want to put some rocks together.
We decided that it would be a good end to this day, to take a group photo. It was the only photo we'd have had of all of us together.
Lorry scorpion is the most common species in Jordan and in the Middle East. Also, it is the most poisonous species in the whole world. We should take great care when we turn the stones over, because it hides during the daytime.
Stung by a scorpion.
I just looked at Ian and then looked at the scorpion and you just thought, what's going to happen next?
Oh, it's so painful.
It's a cafe. You might have something down there.
Yeah, but give me that.
I think we'll do something. I'll just stop the venom.
I just knew that a small scorpion could be fatal. The first thing to do was to stop the venom moving around the body, put some sort of tourniquet on.
It's highly dangerous. Its venom could be lethal if the victim didn't get the proper medical care. If a person gets stung, he should go to hospital and have anti-venom as soon as possible.
I don't know anything about scorpions, but I know that if you get stung by a snake, you should try and capture the snake because it's important to get the right kind of anti-venom.
We wanted to get it into a container that everyone could see. So the only thing we had was a water bottle.
You got him? Oh, fabulous.
Ian looked quite shocked and his leg was hurting so much that it seemed to be stiffening up. He wasn't looking particularly great.
You're right.
Oh.
Okay.
Oh, yes.
Yeah?
God, it's really painful.
Does it happen very much?
Yes, many times it's happened.
But he will be okay.
Yeah, it's okay. I make for him medicine. Time is very important. Without any care, he will last for maybe 4 hours. The person needs to take a medical care as soon as possible.
Oh my God.
The guy cut Ian's leg with a rusty razor blade, which I think Ian was more scared of at the time than he was over the scorpion. And he also put sugar and potato over the cut.
It didn't quite tie up with what I was thinking, with small scorpions, especially small yellow scorpions, being potentially fatal. But I was standing there thinking, this guy must know what he's talking about, because he lives up there.
Thank you.
With the cafe owner saying it is very, very painful, but they do recover, that allayed our fears.
Come on, guys, let's have one for posterity.
I can't believe it's taking
prison. We can't take the chance to wait just if the potato is good for the venom or not. After 15 minutes, he will feel numbness in whole of his leg. After that, a profuse sweating and salivation will occur. He will feel dehydration in the pharynx here. He could be died after maybe 4 hours.
It's really hurt.
Well, it's sort of pins and needles, really. Sort of numbness all the way down this side of the leg.
It didn't seem to be getting any better. It's all I could think of. We need to get Ian down the mountain quickly.
I'd rather stay here for a few minutes if that's all right.
Really?
Yeah.
You can't manage to walk
in. No.
It was decided that Jerry and I should run down and that Mark and Caroline should stay.
See you later.
See you later.
Yeah, okay.
We set off running at quite a pace, but it's a very steep, rocky path, so we had to concentrate quite carefully. First aid post. At the back of my mind was the lifeline. I thought, well, maybe that's why I noticed it on the way up.
filled my mouth.
Hey, come on in.
The pain started a bit more. Yeah. Ian quite got the shakes, looked a bit pale and things like this.
I think we should think about moving in a minute.
You couldn't see it, but you could imagine it spreading all through his body and it started to burn him as well. And we decided that no matter what, we had to start making move. We were stuck at least 45 minutes walk up a mountain. And I was thinking, the one thing I remember about a venomous sting is keep the victim calm and elevate the affected part of the body. Well, that was his knee. And I was thinking, you know, how are we going to get him down a mountain with his knee above his head?
Steady.
Oh.
All right.
Yep.
Take care.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It was the end of the day. There weren't many tourists around. Everyone else had gone home. It did seem quite unreal at the time. It was a long, long way up there.
Right, so steady. We're going to die when we get back, I tell you.
All I could think of to do was to talk to him. And I know it sounds daft, but kind of to make light of the situation, to try and make him laugh, because, you know, if Ian looked into our eyes and saw that we were really frightened too, that he would get more frightened, and that kind of terror feeds on itself.
It's about 20-25 minutes getting down the mountain. Certainly our legs felt like jelly as we got to the bottom.
Yep.
And everyone had gone. All the tourists seemed to have disappeared.
I was appalled when I saw the first aid post was closed.
So suddenly we found ourselves looking around, trying to find someone to help.
Look, there's somebody out there. Titi.
Yes, please.
Our friend is up at the monastery. He's stung by a scorpion, his leg. Got a doctor?
Absolutely, we have no doctors here. Any medicine down
nothing,
here for this?
Nothing, nothing at all.
Any
here.
Phones, anything like that?
Nothing, nothing at all. Anything just like we're going to come with you to get okay. him down.
And so okay, then, okay. having... come down the mountain, we then turned round to run back up again.
Doing great.
We must have met Ian and the party coming down about an hour and a half after he was stung.
I was very relieved to see Ian. I thought that he did have that sort of pale grey look about him that was quite shocking to see.
He will find difficulties in breathing, feel cold all the time, and all the time shivering. The lung will be filled with the fluid, so he can't breathe anymore.
We were hoping that there would be some sort of vehicle that could take us back to where our car was so that we could take Ian to the local hospital. But of course we got down and there was nothing. We knew that there was still this massive hike back to where our car was.
I had visions of us making this slow, slow progress, with time against us and daylight against us, back through the whole site. It would just be a nightmare to go back that way.
There's a truck there. There might be somebody who can help.
The cafe owner was loading up his pickup truck at the end of the day, clearly preparing to go, and he was, from a transport point of view, he was our only hope.
Could you take us to a hospital
yes,
or
yes,
a clinic?
Yes, to a clinic, yes.
How far is it?
15 minutes.
Can you take us now?
Yes, steady.
We're going to have to pay, aren't we, and then...
I've hardly got any money left. I don't think we've got any money left.
It was a 10-mile journey to the town of Petra.
It's getting dark. It's starting to get dark.
The journey was a bit frantic, and we were just thinking, oh, we've got to get a move on, we've got to get a move on.
It's Friday. Never find a bank open
now. I mean, the town must be closing up by now.
It must be over 2 hours by now.
It's got to be.
I don't think it's too fast.
No, I know. We're nearly there now, so...
When we got to the clinic, I think, first of all, there was relief that we'd actually arrived somewhere. But it was quite strange. I don't remember seeing any signs outside that said it was a clinic.
I wasn't very optimistic at what sort of clinic could be up this stairway, you know, whether it was going to be somebody operating out of a kitchen or what. It looked as if we were, you know, popping into somebody's flat.
As soon as we got to the doctor's, things just started to happen. And the doctor went straight to Ian and just went into, like, battle action.
When he came to my clinic, he's in very critical condition. He may die. He has very low blood pressure. The pulse was very weak and heart rate is very low.
Ian was going into what I later found out was anaphylactic shock. He started shaking and he started going pale and he started to have another reaction against the venom. I was very worried. that even despite the antivenom and everything, that we were just too late.
This is the scorpion? Yeah, you see the scorpion?
Yeah. Okay.
All right.
The doctor was putting up drips, and I thought by this time he would just be getting better, but he suddenly just dipped and seemed to crash.
Hold up.
And I remember thinking, hold on a minute. You know, I was thinking, I want him to tell me more. The doctor got him anti-venom, antihistamine, I think adrenaline or something else like that. But then it was like a complete moment of Monty Python in the middle of it all.
I want to have a torch.
What?
I want to have a torch.
The power failed.
Come there, mate.
Yeah.
We were trying to find Ian's backside with the light of my torch. In that kind of situation, it's great when you have something funny or calming happens because it's just such a relief.
Oh, my.
Okay, that's.
I mean, I know you're a bit shy.
The doctor moved him into another room, which also served as the dentist's surgery. The doctor made him sit there until his blood pressure came back up.
Ian had been within minutes of death, but a few hours after receiving the life-saving treatment, he was out of danger and later carried on with the holiday.
Hello, Ian.
Hello.
How are you?
A lot better, thank you.
Hello.
Yeah, much better.
The doctor was amazing. He was very calm and efficient. It must have been quite a shock, I would think, to have us all suddenly turn up on his doorstep quite late at night. I think it was only later when you can feel sort of frightened about what may have happened. There was this amazing kind of shooting pain, like an electric shock almost up and down my leg. And I really did think, oh, I might just fall down dead right here. And I remember stupidly thinking, well, if you're going to die somewhere, in a lot worse places to die with this amazing view. Everyone was amazing. I mean, I hadn't known the group we were with for very long, and obviously didn't know the locals at all until this all happened. But everyone was... Well, I suppose I owe them my life. I have no problem with scorpions. I mean, it was my fault. I knelt on it.
If you ever go out camping in the desert, you don't go poking around under bushes and trees and stones night or day without thinking about what's under them.
It's a big day for Tom Duggan and the other fire school recruits. The start of a crucial course where they'll learn how to use breathing apparatus and tackle the ultimate danger, a flashover.
The situation that we were training for today is the most extreme adverse conditions that they will encounter. They're going to be on the floor because there's nowhere else for them to survive.
First, though, the recruits experience just how hot a fire can get in a confined space. They soon learn the lower they get, the cooler they stay.
It surprises all of them what their limits are, and really, that's what this course is about. It's partly the knowledge of wearing the sets of the firefighting techniques, but it's also about knowing your own limits and just how far you can go. They've gone into a compartment fire, which is your typical bedroom in a modern house, which is totally enclosed. You've got double glazing. There's nowhere for the heat to escape to. All that's lacking in that environment is oxygen. As soon as they open the door, they feed the fire with oxygen and the hot gas ignites. And so suddenly the whole room catches fire.
The first team are in. Tom Duggan and Dan Burke have to fight the fire and rescue a casualty as fast as they can.
The difference between on your belly and then on your knees is possibly 300 or 400 degrees. Without this fire kit, you don't live for more than 2 minutes in a fire. Because the heat's that intense, you're just like bacon crisps. It's that hot.
The fire in there was not a particularly harsh fire, was it?
No.
Yeah? But the amount of water that you were throwing around in there, converting to steam, you're going to be taking the punishment. Not only you, the casualty that's in there is going to be taking the punishment. The conditions are getting worse all the time. You'll never, ever put a fire out firing across it. That's why your arm needs to be up and angle the hose reel down on the big figure of eight, OK? Because if not, the spray is just going to go over the top of the flame. I know it's a pain in the backside coming over that concrete step, but you've got to stay down. Should anything happen and it flashes across 3,000 degrees centigrade, it's going to have your face off. All right?
For five of the recruits, it's pressure of a different kind. They failed last week's big exams, and before they can go into the firehouse, they have to be reassessed on their basic drills.
At this time in the course, their technical ability should be at a higher level than it is today. The first drill that we saw out there today, albeit there were a couple of minor mistakes, but it was a better drill than we saw last week. They're certainly on the up. They're improving, but they're not at a level still that they should be at the 6 weeks stage.
Head right! Push it, lads!
Come on, lads, head right!
Heel left! Well, Paul!
This is where, you know, I get a little bit nervous. I think this is where everyone gets nervous, on the practical side. Because there's so many things that you have to remember. And that's why it's so important to pass, because I don't know what I'd do if I didn't pass.
Lower by one round!
I thought he got it right. I thought.
Extend by two rounds!
It was the first drill. There was a couple of errors within it, which I put down to nerves of reassessment, despite the preamble, despite you trying to calm them down. The level of competency for 6 weeks on ladder work alone with regard to the second pitch is crap, for want of a better word.
But the thing was, the first time it was spot on.
It was, yeah, and then he decided to...
three times.
And he corrected it wrongly.
Wrong.
Yeah. So calm that down and let's start again.
Yeah.
And I'll get a fresh marking sheet out. I think I haven't seen those two.
Take it.
Show them the first marking sheets.
Now, don't, for goodness sake.
I'm going to show them that.
Don't demoralise them.
Meanwhile, it's the next team's turn in the firehouse, after a last-minute reminder of what's expected.
Get to the top of the head of the stairs. Feel for the door. I don't want to see you kneeling up in front of that door. I want you taking adequate and full cover by the wall. Now, when you go through, open the door. One, two. One, two, three. Close the door, wait your 20 seconds. One, two, and in.
70, 80, 90, 20. One,
two, in. This time, they make a tactical mistake. They spend too long trying to put out the flames while the casualty is left to burn.
Had that been for real, we would have been looking shit creek. Yeah? We didn't fight the fire. We went in there for a wander around to have a look, see what was going on. I expect better than that.
So?
Who was number one?
Me.
You went into the corner and stayed in the corner, waiting for your mate to come. Getting lonely.
No.
Didn't bother to feel out to your left or right.
I was doing that, so.
You're doing that. Yeah, that's what you were doing. Yeah? We weren't over here, were we? No. We weren't searching for the door. You were told before you went in. Then we find the door. Yeah? Mr. Evans, you decide you're going to stay on your knees when it's open. Yeah? You've got a special dispensation? Because if you have, I'm an instructor. Please tell me. Show me. I ain't got one. You ain't got one.
So.
Gents, I despair. I really do. Both me and my colleagues have wasted 1 week's input. Yeah? Sort it out. Go away and reflect on it. Yeah.
Back on the yard, things are going better for the retake recruits. But will they have done enough to pass this time?
Yes!
First time in there, so we just done craps, is that?
This is just a quick result to let you know that you've all passed. Yeah? Yourself. I'm going to talk to each and every one of you individually because there are one or two of you are still showing some weakness and we need to address those problems. Yeah? But well done today. The ADO is impressed how dramatically your standards improved. Yeah? You've got to keep that going now. You've got another 6 weeks.
You passed. Do it.
Yeah.
In there.
Yeah.
Right.
Sam's the parent, mate. Cheers.
No.
He's an amateur.
Good man. Good man. Boydie, we passed.
Boyd, we're through there, mate.
Come on.
There you go.
Good man.
Don't forget, lads. 25 past PA lecture room.
Don't forget. Pop that Debbie boy me a drink.
Yeah, right.
Next week, it's pitch black and the recruits have minutes to rescue their lost colleague.
We've got two dead firemen.
We've got two dead firemen, yeah. Unfortunately, they're going the wrong side of the building.
Epilepsy is a condition which affects hundreds of thousands of people to a greater or lesser extent. It's a temporary malfunction of the nerve cells in the brain, which can cause someone to have a violent seizure. Seizures happen almost at random, but they can also be triggered by flashing lights or fast-moving patterns. They're rarely serious unless someone having a seizure falls into harm's way or injures themselves really badly, which is what happened to Mark Howell from Birkenhead in our next story.
I've suffered from epilepsy all my life. Since I was 7 months old, I suffered from meningitis and it developed into epilepsy afterwards.
Mark has epilepsy and minor learning difficulties, and consequently, he attends the day centre.
I remember leaving the centre and walking along Duke Street, along the bus, past the bus stop, going through Birkenhead Park Station, and down the stairs I went. As I was waiting for the train, I looked at my watch, and that's all I can remember, really. I thought he was drunk. There was something quite not right with the way that he was moving. I was expecting him to stop, but he didn't. He just kept walking. And he just went right over the edge. And for about 2-3 seconds, I just stood there trying to register what I'd seen. I just ran as fast as I possibly could. And I looked down, and he was still shaking. Obviously, he wasn't drunk, but he was having an epileptic fit.
There's a man on the line! Get the power switched off!
His head was on the second rail, and his feet were on the first rail. I jumped down, which is a very stupid thing to do. The danger of live rail didn't really register at all because of the size of Mark. There was just no way that I was going to be able to pick him up, especially him having a fit. It'd be like trying to lift a dead weight. I've never been more scared in my life. The realisation dawned that the train wasn't going to stop in time. The first thought that came into my head was just to get out of the way. Something inside me just made me stay. I grabbed Mark, dragged him so that he was parallel to the first and second rail. As far as I was concerned at that time, I'd failed. He had died.
There's a man under the train!
I remember closing my eyes as I knelt down. Expecting to see the worst.
to actually see him still be there. It was like being told some fantastic news. It was brilliant.
You'll be all right. Look, there are people coming. Just hold on.
He was still having a fit, still totally oblivious to what was going on. But he was okay. He hadn't moved from the position that I'd laid him in.
You, come off there.
The conductor asked me to get off the line as he was evacuating the station. I remember feeling very, very angry because I wouldn't know what happened to Mark.
Phil Bartley from Mark's day centre was called to the station after someone recognised Mark.
When you hear that somebody's fallen under a tray, you expect the worst. I did not expect to find Mark unhurt, but was relieved to find that he was all right. He was in one piece.
Do you want to go and reassure him again?
Mark, you hear me?
The most I could do was just stay by the side of the track and talk to Mark, just to keep his spirits up.
Okay.
The live rail had been turned off so the train couldn't be moved, and firefighters used a split stretcher to drag Mark out.
All right, Mark.
OK, mate, listen, you're the luckiest man alive.
The following morning, I went to the station and I actually asked the ticket conductor if he actually knew if he'd survived the evening. And to my relief, he'd only sustained a small cut on his head and a number of broken ribs. But other than that, he was fine. He was actually going to be released that afternoon, which was brilliant. It was all black under the train. I was wondering where I was. I mean, it was quite frightening. Tony, he deserves more than a big thank you for saving me life. And that's all I can say, really.
The British Transport Police agreed with Mark and together with the Royal Humane Society presented Tony with an award for his life-saving courage. Tony Morris in that story was obviously very brave to rescue Mark, but he also realised almost from the start what was happening. It's very easy to mistake a seizure for drunkenness or else be frightened off by the person's uncontrollable jerking, but you could be of great help to someone suffering an epileptic seizure. Paramedic Clive Hadrill has this advice.
Epilepsy is caused by a brief disruption to the normal workings of the brain, similar to an electrical storm. There are two main types of seizure. Now, partial epilepsy is when suddenly someone may switch off, almost as if they're daydreaming. They may pull at their clothes, smack their lips, or swallow repeatedly. If you think someone is having a seizure, try and guide them away from any potential danger. Try not to interrupt the seizure, but talk to them calmly and reassuringly, and stay with them until they feel better. Witnessing a severe epileptic seizure can be distressing, but don't panic, you can help. They'll fall unconscious, often letting out a cry, and may even stop breathing for a short period of time. Their body will stiffen and jerk uncontrollably. If you see a person having a seizure, don't be frightened to approach them, but don't move them unless they're in immediate danger. Clear a space around them so they don't hurt themselves. Cushion their head with something soft, or use your arm. Loosen the clothing around their neck, and stop people from crowding around. There are three things you should never do. Never try to restrain the person having the seizure. Let it run its course. Never put anything in their mouth, or force anything between their teeth. Despite what you may have heard, there is no risk of them swallowing in their tongue. And never give them anything to drink during their seizure. Once the seizure slows down and stops, a period of confusion, headache, and sleepiness often follows. Put them into the recovery position, check that they're breathing, and stay with them until they feel better. You may not need to call an ambulance, but if you're in any doubt at all, dial 999. Generally, people having a seizure do not injure themselves, but it can be very embarrassing. Just knowing somebody's there offering a helping hand can make a difference.
Summer's round the corner. We'll all be getting out and about more. A good reason for making sure now that you know the basics of first aid. Book a place on the 999 Roadshow. Tonight, we're offering places at a roadshow to be held at the Portland Leisure Centre in Nottingham on Saturday the 30th and Sunday the 31st of May. Call us now on 0891 339 999. The lines close at midnight. The Morris Minor has been a favourite on our streets for half a century. It was introduced in 1948, and more than a million of them had been built by the time production finished in 1971. Now, people who own Morris Minors tend to treat them almost as one of the family, and invariably they give them names. Judith Moore from Norfolk called hers Moggy, and she contacted our website to tell us how Moggy actually saved her life when a lorry overturned on them both. In our reconstruction, members of the emergency services take part as themselves.
Moggy was part of the family since I can remember. It came from a little old lady in Liverpool. Pretty unoriginal name, Moggy. I suppose all Morris Minor owners do that.
Daddy used to call it Moggy Mew. I used to call it Moggy Moggy. And it was a Morris Minor, and that's the real name for it. And it was about 2 million years old.
My husband and I bought it the year before we got married. She'd get occasional polish and wipe, and then I'd feel quite pleased with her. She looked quite good. And there's just lots of family memories associated with it. We drove off in the car from our wedding, but it didn't like going over about 50. It used to protest rather loudly at its little habits.
Moggy was a lovely car. It had a lovely shape on it. It was nice to ride in and didn't make you sick. It was a nice bumpy car to bump around in because it was like these seats really squashy.
A hip-hop hat. I'm giving you all the macaroni.
My best friend's JJ. She's nice because she's a bit like a sister.
You're getting your head.
We're best friends.
We've got a necklace.
It's a best friend necklace, and they're hearts, and they're broken hearts, and you wear them together, and someone has best on theirs, and the other person has friends.
Now hold on to your seats and listen right here. I'm going to tell you something.
It was half term, and I decided to go around Roshi's. And then Roshi and Judith needed to go shopping.
Jojo's mother and I were friends since they were both very small babies. They used to play together and then they went to nursery and playgroup together.
Oh, no, actually,
egged each other on into all sorts chocolates. Of trouble.
We bought quite a lot of carrots. He was quite like carrots.
I came up to the roundabout, which is usually quite busy because it crosses the A11, which is one of the main roads in East Anglia. Then I noticed a large lorry approaching. I thought I showed a little healthy respect and let it go. It just came on me that it wasn't going to straighten up.
When it's about this much away, I thought, no, it's not going to stop.
At that moment, I had no doubt that we were all going to be killed. From 1 minute, it was, you know, a very normal, everyday situation. And then instantly, a tremendous noise, metal crushing and glass shattering and flying everywhere. The bonnet of the car was squashed down and squashed towards me at the same time. The steering wheel, which on a Morris Minor is pretty big, flattened so far it went into my legs. The worst thing was that I couldn't do anything to save the children. I knew how frightened they were. And I was almost relieved to hear that they were still screaming because I knew that they were conscious and feeling something.
She was saying, "Please, could you help us, God?" And she was saying little swear words.
I did swear, as the children said, some pretty rude words. I found that helped quite considerably.
I can't believe this.
I need some milk.
It's all right, Jojo, just calm down.
You're all right.
You're okay.
I can't move. Just get the kids out.
This man pulled me out, and he was nice because he gave me a hug. And he said, "It'll be okay because your mum will probably be coming out soon." I didn't really want to leave just to see if she could come out.
There's been an accident on the A11 roundabout at Thetford. There's a Morris Minor under a lorry. A lady trapped inside.
As we came up the hill, straight away I realised that we had an incident which was obviously going to test us fully.
These children away from
here. Had all the makings of a lengthy rescue.
Don't worry, we're going to get you moved in a second or two. OK, she's in a really precarious position here. Let's get the lot blocked up and see if we can get some lift.
The car itself appeared to be giving some support to that lorry. A modern vehicle is not designed like the old-style Morris Minor. I really believe that had she been in a more modern car, this situation would have been a very, very different outcome. We had to get things put in place to ensure that there was no chance of further movement.
My fear was that the car would crush down even further. I was in a lot of pain from top of my legs, but from the knee down, I couldn't really feel anything at all. It just felt as if they were wrapped up in metal, like a sardine can.
We were starting to deploy things like our own high and low pressure airbags.
At the moment, it looks like lower limbs, badly trapped. I don't know about the back.
You're going to need a bag, but this is going to need to be lifted. The bags are stabilised.
That's
the
limit.
We were expecting to find quite serious leg and possibly pelvic injuries as well.
The very worst scenario, we're looking at a partial amputation from the sheer weight of the lorry. The lorry was literally sitting in Judith's lap.
Keep your ears peeled on this. If you hear any creaking, cross out and let us know, OK? We're getting everything in we can.
That's a paramedic coming in. I'm going to hand them over to you, right?
I actually climbed in through the rear window and sat with her.
OK, paramedic. Now, I can't see the bottom half of your legs.
We couldn't see the legs, we couldn't feel the legs. All we had to go on with what she was telling us.
Got two problems now. First of all, we've got all the airbags in, but it's not going to lift the side of it. Also, the side of the lorry's flexing. We're not lifting the lorry, we're bowing the side.
Get the back of the wagon open. OK, find out what we got in there, and if that's possible at all, to handball it. Let's get some of the stuff shifting. It's full of carrots.
Get some buckets.
Oh, guys,
get some containers.
Once the lorry was supported, firefighters started the long job of unloading.
So what we had was a sea of carrots becoming deeper and deeper and deeper. It was making it very difficult.
Bring the container up here.
I must admit that the scene was slightly amusing compared with the very different and grave situation that we had outside. Very little progress was made in the early stages. I knew that we were not going to achieve a successful lift.
Yeah, can you get a message back to control for us, please? Contact John Allen Recovery. We need the pneumatic lifting unit. We want large diameter bags. It'd be preferable if it also bring a twin jib crane.
I needed to have bigger equipment. I was bouncing ideas off my colleagues at that stage about the possibilities of having to move that car with the casualty still trapped in it. That, for us, is an absolute no-no. Had there been spinal damage to suddenly jolt that vehicle, could have worsened the casualty situation.
One way I wanted to fall asleep, you know, and hopefully it would all be over. But another part was a bit more cynical and thought, if I do, I might not wake up again.
How's your neck?
It's all right.
There's no pain in your neck?
As soon as the pain was brought under control, she relaxed. She became quite chatty. We just made small talk, really, for an hour and a half.
How's the pain now, Judith?
I knew that it was taking a long time, but you had to believe that it would work in the end. You either laugh or you cry.
There's some chocolates in the front. And I just asked casually if I could have one.
Yeah, I've got to look out there. Yeah, pass them round.
She said, well, yes, pass them round, but save me the coffee creams.
Very much.
I was really annoyed about that, because I hate coffee creams. It's my daughter who likes them.
Andy, do you want a chocolate?
This lady was remarkable.
Right, Judy, you're doing
absolutely
fine,
remarkable.
Okay.
Very calm, given the situation that she was in. We've explored every avenue, and I now seriously have to consider moving the vehicle where the lady's still trapped. That, for me, is probably one of the hardest decisions that I've had to make in a very long time. I had a conversation with the paramedic about her condition. I wanted his reassurance that she hadn't got spinal damage.
The fireman, I think, wanted me to get out. Judith wanted me to stay, and I was happy to do so.
Once they've got that casualty stable, and they say go,
that's enough, Steve.
That's when we give it everything we got. We had airbags of all descriptions all the way along the underside of that vehicle. A rollover lift from the back using the crane, winch from the fire appliance on the back of the car. There was no room for failure. This was it. This was our one chance. And to my delight, I saw the Morris Thousand start to ease backwards. You could nearly feel the draft from the sigh of relief. The paramedic indicating to me, fine, we're happy, don't stop. I didn't want to stop. I wanted to see that thing come right out. All of that work that poor lady had been stuck in that car. And only now could we begin a standard extraction from a very damaged car.
Keep it up.
Yeah.
Well done, you're doing fine.
It was memorably painful. I think I told them to leave me alone. It hurt too much. But underneath, I was very, very glad to be free.
Given the fact she had a 40-ton lorry sitting in her lap, to get away with one broken leg is quite remarkable.
I was just amazed that we came out of that as we did.
The A11 had been completely closed for nearly 2 hours by the time Judith was finally freed.
Had Judith have pulled up 6 inches, maybe a foot further forward when she stopped at that roundabout, for Judith Moore, that would have been a very different situation. My first vehicle was a Morris Thousand. It's always sad to see a Moggy go when you've owned one. Morris Minor is certainly a strong little car. It's the classic egg shape. And I think we all realise how much strength there is in such a thin little eggshell. I think that family owe a lot to that little car.
Moggy was a lovely car, and she had a strong roof. So she probably saved our lives. Life and death situation, so I think we're better friends now.
Yeah.
A lot better. Friendship never ends if you wanna be. We got a new car. It's a modern one. It's quite, not really that posh.
It's a Japanese car. I don't think it has the same place in my affections. Moggy was my car. It was part of the family, so you can't replace the Moggy. If you want to be my lover.
Next week, into the underworld. A canoeist is swept away and nobody knows whether he's dead or alive. Plus, the medical breakthrough from behind the former Iron Curtain that saves a biker's leg after a crash on his honeymoon. To reserve your place on the 999 Lifesaver Roadshow, call us now on 0891 339 999. And to obtain a copy of the 999 Family Safety video, send a cheque for £9.99 to BBC Education, PO Box 7, London W12 8UD. You'll find more details about tonight's programme on our website and CFAX page.